What is going on?
Oh, I like this color.
Thank you, my love. You know, I be trying to change it up a bit, you know?
Girl, listen, you know, as Black women, we change our hair all the time, and I feel like people don't understand that.
I mean, to be honest, I feel that I've always said, even though that my hair has always been a topic of conversation. Right. Oh, wait, hold on. Oh, look at this filter. Wait, hold on. I'm trying to make myself look cute or whatever. I don't find y'all as dumb. However, I just felt like, oh my God, what am I doing right now? What is going on? Okay.
There you go.
Yes, however, I have a part of me, but it's not who I am. Right. So I think that the hair of a woman is part of you, but it doesn't define who you are. So you should feel comfortable to change looks, to try different colors. It's fun. It's like wearing different outfits.
Yes, right? It's like we're different people when we have different hair on. And I wish people would understand that. But it looks amazing. I love color on you, girl. Well, Miss Amada, thank you so much for joining us.
Yes.
Thank you for being here. So I always ask everyone this question. How are you doing during this pandemic? And what are you doing to stay busy?
This is going to sound terrible. There's a part of me that loves it. I love a certain level of COVID. I mean, not COVID. I'm sorry. The pandemic. Right. I meant to say the pandemic. Not COVID. Lord knows not. The pandemic. Only because I feel that I've been able to enjoy more time with my mom. Because usually as an artist, you're always traveling. I've been able to enjoy some time with my mom. I've been able to actually do gardening, which is something that she loves and enjoys to do. I've been able to actually enjoy the things that I have purchased. Sometimes you are so caught up that you don't actually enjoy your household. Yes. I've never looked at my sofa, my bed, my seats the way that I have, because now I truly appreciate it since I've had so much time to be, you know, in my house. So, you know, there's been great things about this pandemic, and then bad things. I'll give you an exclusive. My father has COVID, and yesterday I had to actually call 911. I had to call an ambulance for him. He was having lots of difficulties breathing. For those that saw the third season of Love and Hip Hop, I publicly announced that he had prostate cancer, and it's just a lot. So I've been trying to be the best daughter that I can during this time and be as productive as possible.
Yeah. And I just want to say we are sending our love and prayers to you and your family, to you and your dad. And thank you so much for even doing this, because I know it's a lot, because especially dealing with family members who have cancer and then like with COVID. And I know sometimes the fans can be a little embracive sometimes. So thank you for just, you know, being here. And we are sending our love to you.
Amen. Thank you. I appreciate that.
You are very, very welcome. So, of course, during this pandemic, there's been a lot going on, girl.
Yes.
Black Lives Matter, BLM, and you have been very active. You've been in these streets protesting. You've been using your social media. So why is the Black Lives Matter movement so important to you?
Well, because I'm Black. The hell?
Okay.
The fuck was it?
But like, sometimes, because there's some Black people, there were some Black people who were like,
you know what? This may not... I don't know exactly how to word it, and please forgive me if my words may not come out right in this moment. With the title of Black Lives Matter or without the title of Black Lives Matter, I would still always stand up for justice. You know, because I know the background and I know that there is more to just the name of Black Lives Matter, right? We're not going to get into those details. But regardless, to me, it's about supporting and standing up for justice and standing up for what's right. I have always been an activist for the Afro-Latino community because I always said that we didn't have enough representation. As a matter of fact, on Thursday, I'm going to be hosting a major award show called Premios Juventud on Univision. It's major for the Latin community. And unfortunately, there is still a very, very small, to not say none at all, because I'll be there, a lack of representation of us. You know, so Black Lives Matter, the movement, the George Floyd situation among so many, so Breonna Taylor among so many, because I feel like there's just so many other names to mention that haven't gotten any justice, that of course I feel that is important. I feel that it is important for my generation and for the generation to come. I worry for the life of my children, which I don't have any, but in due time, if I don't do anything now, what will the life of my grandchildren look like if this is 2020?
Exactly. You are absolutely right. And that's why I love this, because you also are a part of a platform online on Facebook called Not Under Our Watch, which I thought was super dope. So for the fans who don't know, let them know what Not Under Our Watch is and how they can buy that.
Not Under Our Watch is something that my team and I came up with. Shout outs to Jambalaya, Michelle, Gail, and all my team. We wanted to do something where people can just go ahead and find all the information that they wanted as far as voting, as far as marches, protests. Everything that you want to find, you can just find it in one solid place. So guys, most definitely go check out notunderourwatch.com. And I just, not just going to marches. I felt that going to marches and protesting, you know, it's important because of awareness. But then I always say, then what happens after that? You know, to a certain extent, I'm not going to lie, I feel uncomfortable and I've been wanting to curse people out on social media because I feel like, you know, yes, people had a big momentum with George Floyd and Black Lives Matter. And then you look now and the momentum is gone. It's almost like it was trendy to put the black square and to do all those things. But I'm like, what happens now? Are you guys still not going to fight? Are you guys still not going to do anything? I'm going to be part of, I've actually done 3 protests down here in Miami already.
Yes.
I'm actually traveling to Washington, D.C. March 22nd, I believe, to do another march.
Nice.
And I will continue to do as much as I can. I don't do it for clout. I don't do it for none of that. I do it because I've been doing it since I was 17 years old, way before Love and Hip Hop, way before all this stuff. I really am about that life.
Yeah, you are. And that's why I love it, because you've been doing it since the beginning of time. And you're right. It's kind of like those black squares. Now that that's all gone, it's like, hello. So this was just a trend for you.
Right.
But it's all good. We are here doing it. But something else that you're doing, you have a brand new single called Andale, and you have a video where you look bomb AF. And I love this single because you're rapping, which is something a little different for you. Because I remember, I think I seen an interview where you said that you were out of your comfort zone a little bit.
Yeah.
So what made you want to do the rapping? Because I think it sounds amazing. I love it. I watched your video like 50 times. I was like, she was great.
You know what? I don't consider myself to be a rapper. You know, I don't consider myself to be a rapper, but if I have to rap, I'll come through and I'll rap. I think the music is about having fun, being creative, and putting no limits to your art. It's like I say, you don't know if you like something unless you've tried it. And what's going to stop me? Like, there's no right or wrong way. I think that the only wrong way is to not do anything at all. So I was willing to be risky, to try something out of my comfort zone, which is to do hip hop or rap. And as a matter of fact, I made sure to still have a little bit of the Latin influence. In this case, I wanted to mix a little bit of the Mexican culture with hip hop, with the rap. So I thought that it was cool. It was something interesting to do. And as a matter of fact, I'm thinking actually of putting out and I did a song on my first EP, actually my only EP, Unstoppable. And there's a song that I always wanted to promote and really push, and I never had the opportunity to. And I think that this time around, I think this is the perfect time. It's called Not Tonight. Guys, feel free to go check it out on YouTube, on all social media platforms, on all digital music platforms. It's called Not Tonight. And knowing, you know me, I always try to do things that are beyond just having fun. Knowing everything that has happened with the domestic abuse, how it's peaked. You know, there's been so many women that because of the pandemic, they have had to be locked up in their household, in terrible marriages, in terrible relationships, suffering of domestic abuse. And this song has a very deep meaning, and it goes perfect with that. So I wanted to do something to motivate and empower women to leave abusive relationships. So definitely that will be the next single I'm going to be pushing.
Yes, that's great. You always have a great message, and you always make sure that you put it out there. And that's what I love about you. And I think that's what the audience loves about you. And of course, a lot of people were introduced to you from Love & Hip Hop Miami. But girl, you've been doing it since you were a little girl, singing and dancing. So for those who may not know, maybe they're under a rock, how did it first start out for you? Because originally you started off dancing.
Yeah, so I started when I was 4 years old as a child star. But I was a child star in the Latin market. I started in this very well-known show called Don Francisco with Sábado Gigante with Don Francisco.
Which I used to watch.
Yes? Oh my God.
I don't understand a lot of Spanish. I understand a little bit, but I used to watch the show all the time.
Yes, I was there for 6 years every Saturday. Then I did commercials for Disney, Oscar Mayer Wiener. Like, my mom had me very active. I did 1,000 beauty pageants. My mom was one of those psychotic beauty pageant moms. So, you know, I'm very grateful that she supported me, unlike a lot of parents that have talented children and don't give them an opportunity. My mom, instead of telling me no, which I always say, my mom, instead of saying no, she actually got an extra job. She had a part-time job besides her regular job just to be able to pay for my singing classes and my dancing classes and my acting classes and all those things. And thanks to her effort, I'm here today, and I'm definitely grateful. So I encourage, if you have talented children, give them an opportunity, because you never know if she's going to be the next Beyonce, if she's going to be the next Oprah, if she's going to be the next, you just never know. So if
the,
you
next
have a
child,
the next Amara, just support, you know what I mean? Just give them an opportunity. And I know that it can be very hard. My mom was a single mother. She had an immigrant, no papers, and she still made it happen. So it's possible.
I love it. And I love seeing the relationship with you and your mom on television, because I'm the only child. And it was just like me and my mom and great-grandmother growing up. So I love seeing the dynamic, because that's how me and my mom are today. So I just love seeing that. So, of course, Love & Hip Hop, Miami, season 3. A lot of people know you from the show. And, you know, there are a lot of pros and cons when it comes to reality TV. I work behind the scenes in TV, baby. I work on the production side. So there is a lot of pros and cons. So do you ever regret anything? Or are you one of those people that's like, you know what? I did it. I'm here. It is what it is.
I am not the type of person to regret the things that I do. Whether it's good or whether it's bad, I'm not that person. And sometimes it's been bad and I'll cry. Oh, my God. And my mom will be there to give me encouraging words and stuff like that. But I usually try not to regret, because every single experience that I have lived has made me the woman that I am today. And no matter how bad it's been at the moment, I have most definitely learned something from it. So, you know, Love & Hip Hop has had its good, okay? Has had its ups and its downs. And at the same time, you have to understand what type of show it is. You know what I mean? Like, you know what you're getting yourself into. And it's all about what you make of it. There's only so much you can control, because you have productions, you have editing, you have cast members, you have a lot of things. But, you know, I believe I have done the best that I can, you know, out of the show.
You did. And we love it. And it's very honest. And again, like, a lot has happened and you put everything forward and you've showed us a lot and you've invited us in. And that's what I love to see, how vulnerable you are and how honest you are. But something else I love about you, it's not just reality TV. You are part of a Black Lady sketch show, which is now Emmy nominated for the Bad Bitch Support Group. Congratulations. And
thank
all that.
You.
So how did you get the call to be a part of that? Because that's something completely different.
Yes, actually, I got a call and I was offered the opportunity of participating. Would you be interested? You know, and I said most definitely, to know that it was going to be an all-woman type of show. And they wanted to be innovative, try something different. To me, it was definitely an honor. I had never done it. And I was honored to be able to work with Angela Bassett as well. She's an amazing actress and among so many talented women. So it was just great. And I was like, I can't wait to do it again. I was actually planning on moving to L.A. for four months, but right before the pandemic. And then that didn't get to happen because I was going to film a TV show for a late night show. We were also, you know, preparing another movie for this year that got postponed as well. You know, a lot of things have gotten postponed and I'm just trying to make the best out of it with what I currently have tangible. So, you know, make the best out of it.
Exactly. Make the best out of it. But speaking about Emmys, I wanted to get your opinion on this. So the Emmy nominations came out and it was a lot of like Black actors, directors. And maybe I think it was like a lot of Black shows. John Leguizamo, an actor, he had reposted this article and he was like, hey, what about the Latinas? And then a lot of Afro-Latinas came out and was like, actually, we've been here, but because of colorism, it seems like we've kind of have been separated from, you know, the Latina community. So, and I know for you, you have been very vocal about colorism in your community, the Latin community, there's colorism in the Black community. So what are your thoughts about that? Because a lot of people were like, hey, Jerome, who's Dominican, just won an Emmy last year. And I think it started a lot of conversations for a lot of Afro-Latinas, because then they started coming out and saying, hey, sometimes we feel like we're not let into a lot of things because of the color of our skin. And for the queen who's been so vocal about it, what do you think about that?
I feel that, you know, you definitely feel and see the difference way more in the Latin community, in the Latin industry than you do the American. I know that there's a lot of Afro-Latinas that will do their best to pass as African-Americans just to get gigs. And it somewhat sucks that you have to pretend to be someone that you're not, or somewhat deny your culture because you want to get booked. And I understand it. Listen, everybody's trying to get their coins, and I get it. I do feel and I do understand how sometimes there can be that big gap of you're not Black enough to be, you know, Black, and you're not Latina enough to be Latina. And no matter sometimes how much we explain it, unless you're put in our shoes, you may not understand. Yeah. We go through colorism, we go through injustices, we go through classism, we go through all those things like everybody else, but it's more like you're Latin, so y'all figure it out over there. And I'm like, yeah, but even if we're Latin and we have to figure it out over there, for people like myself that are born and raised in this country, we somewhat have adapted a lot of other cultures. Like in my case, I grew up in Hialeah, and I also grew up in Brown Sub. If anybody's from Miami, you know what it is. Brown Sub is predominated by African-Americans. And I thought I was African-American for a really long time.
Right.
Even though when I got home, my mom only spoke Spanish, so it could be confusing. I think the lack of education, the lack of understanding can sometimes be the reasons why there are divisions like this. So I do feel that there is a lack of representation of the Afro-Latino community. And, you know, the only thing that I can do is continue to bring awareness, is try to break those barriers by proving to them that it can be done. And I also blame the directors. I also blame producers. I also blame screenwriters. I also blame all these people that have the power to make a difference, and they don't. And they continue to follow the same pattern. They continue to use the same people. And then they want to talk about diversity. Well, 2020 is the year of diversity. 2020 is the year of education. 2020 is the year of breaking barriers. 2020 is the year of growing and showing growth and showing strength. So for those that are like, oh, you know, we want diversity. Well, then if you have the power to make that happen, then do it.
Exactly. That's my thoughts. Exactly. I'm like, it's something to do with the higher ups, and they keep having this cycle and no one is changing it. So they got to be the people to change it. Were you shocked that, like, because I remember when you were first on Love & Hip Hop and you were speaking about being Afro-Latina, were you shocked that a lot of people did not understand what that meant? Because I'm from New York and I have a lot of Afro-Latinas in my family. I grew up in Boston. Okay. So, like, I already knew what was up. And I was shocked that so many people were on social media like, what? I didn't know this was a thing. And I'm like, guys, there's so many different Black people. We're all over the world. Like, there's ethnicity, there's race. But I was shocked that so many people didn't understand what Afro-Latina was. Were you shocked at that?
You know, I wasn't as shocked. No, I wasn't as shocked. Okay. You know why? Because one, as an activist, I had already heard it in the past. But I wasn't shocked because you can't blame the fact that they have a stereotype of what the Latina woman looks like.
Yeah.
For and I've always mentioned these women because I admire them. They're talented women. And I understand that for the African-American, for the American, for the Asian, for many others, they see them as what the Latina should be like. Yeah. Jennifer Lopez, Sofia Vergara, Salma Hayek, you know, these are the stereotypes of what a Latina should look like. And to me, it's like, excuse me, there isn't a Latin country where there isn't Black people.
Okay.
We weren't just dropped off in America, okay? We're all over the world. Why the hell don't they talk about us? On TV, they don't put us. You don't see TV hosts. You don't see soap operas. You don't see movies. You don't see anything where they have people like myself. It's like we don't exist. Nobody talks about us. So it's frustrating when you're trying to have an opportunity and you're like, in the Latin community, is like, well, you know, you're not the stereotype. You're not what we're looking for because you look Jamaican, you look Black, you look Haitian, you look African. So we don't want you. And then when you come to the American, it's like, well, we already have our own struggles and we're already trying to figure it out over here. So you go over there with the Latin people and figure it out over there.
Right.
So, it's kind of hard to figure out where it is that you belong.
Yeah, but I always thank you for giving the platform and being that voice. To me, I feel like you're such a role model. You're a role model to, like, young Black girls, Latina girls, Afro-Latino girls. But you do get a lot of shit, which I don't understand. So how do you keep, like, where does the motivation, where does the positivity come from for you? Because I know sometimes fans can be in comments and they can say a lot of crazy things while you're still out here trying to push the positive agenda. And I know that you are a role model. So where does that come from?
First of all, I want to give a special shout out to Rocky. I love him so much. He has always been a great, he has always been great, and he has always supported me since the day that we met each other. So I'm grateful to him, and I know that he's here live. He's commenting in all of our conversation. I also want to take a second to darle un saludo a todos los latinos que están conectados con nosotros. De corazón se lo agradezco. Yo sé que en estos momentos estoy hablando en inglés porque mi entrevista es en inglés, pero de igual manera estoy aquí con ustedes y los quiero un montón. So for all my Latinos that are in here, I see them saying, speak Spanish. So so going back to the question was, how do I put up with it? Look, sometimes it's hard. Sometimes I'm like, fuck this. I don't care. Da, 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 da. And some days I'm a Libra. I be waking up emotional. Like, oh my God, why are they saying that to me? Like, I'm such a nice person. Why don't you like me? So sometimes it can be hard because a lot of times the same people that you're trying to uplift, the same people that you're trying to break barriers for, is the same people that you're trying to represent and have justice being done for them and equality being done for them. They'll be the same ones to try to step on you or to try to belittle you or to try to make you feel like you're not worthy. Sometimes it's the same black women that I wish that they could support be the same ones to be like, yo, nappy hair and yo, da da da. And I'm like, I'm over here. First of all, yes, I changed looks, but my afro is my signature, is what I stand by, is what I love, is my way to protest, is what makes me feel the most comfortable, is what makes me feel the most beautiful. And I'm like, I'm over here embracing and uplifting and trying to let them see the beauty that is within us. And you hidden. But at the same time, I understand that it's the brainwashed mentality that has been, that has happened from generation to generation that doesn't let them understand their own beauty and their own worth. So I understand the ignorance.
Yeah, same. I'm the same way. It's one of those things where it's like you understand it, you're empathetic, you can be sympathetic too, and you're like, I get it, I understand it. But girl, you are so positive. Keep pushing out that positivity and message, because I know there's so many young people who look up to you. And I know when I seen you on Love & Hip Hop, I was like, oh my God, she's gorgeous. Here's another dark-skinned black girl, someone who looks like me. I was like, yes! So please, people, I know there's younger girls who look up to you. But speaking about kids, you are also an author. And you put out a children's book, which I thought was amazing. So where did that come from? What made you want to dip into that and put out a children's book?
Well, growing up, the only person that I really saw that looked like myself, that I admired, was Celia Cruz. Celia Cruz passed away. And when she passed away, I just felt like, okay, well, who else can I look up to? Because in the Latin community, there's no black artist. Like, there's no one that has made it international like she did. So looking up to her, I was like, okay, now let me find out and let me see in the Latin community who is standing up and who is being a positive image to a certain extent for girls like myself, for black Latinas, for black little girls like myself. Who do they look up to? Yes, we have Beyonce, we have Nicki Minaj, we have all these great American artists, which is what eventually I had to do. I looked up to Whitney Houston, Gloria Gaynor, Donna Summers, Dionne Warwick. I looked up to all these amazing women, but I just felt like, why don't we as Latinas have that too? Why do I have to go look outside of my culture, outside of, you know what I'm saying, to look for that? So I just felt like I want to be able to inspire and motivate the, you know, I don't consider myself to be the most appropriate for children, but I do understand it in my heart. No matter if I twerk, no matter if I wear sexy stuff, I still have a good heart and I still have good intentions. And just because I'm a young woman and I'm living my best life, but when all that shuts down, I stand up and I protest and I fight whatever has to be fought for justice. And when it comes to the young girls, I also want to let them know that they're beautiful, that they're amazing. So I did Amarita's Way. Amarita's Way actually talks about loving yourself, you know, embracing the texture of your hair, the color of your skin, the relationship you should have with your mother. In my case, my mom is my best friend. So I just wanted to let little girls know, you know, love your mom. If you're ever scared, if you fear anything, mommy's your best friend. Whatever it is that happens, talk to mommy, you know? And then I also did the chapter of never giving up. Never give up on your dreams, no matter how big it is, never give up on that. So I just wanted to encourage them. So I did it in Spanish, in English, and in French, available on Amazon. Mm-hmm. You guys can go check it out on Amazon.com, and you can also purchase it on Barnes & Noble as well.
Yeah, that's so amazing. It's super, super dope. I don't have kids, but I was like, if I did, I'd be getting that book.
You know what? I don't have no kids either, girl, but let me tell you, the way that this world's looking right now, I'm kind of scared.
Okay, listen, I'm like, I don't know. I might not be bringing no kids up into this crazy world.
I don't know, but eventually, oh my God, let me tell you about my midlife crisis real quick.
Where is the buzz? You said it was mine.
Where is the buzz?